everyone. Welcome to Everyone Has a Story with Liza Page. My guest artist today is the iconic singer and entertainer Craig Douglas, whose career is in one of the toughest businesses in the world, spans no less than 53 years. Craig, thank you so very much for allowing us into your home today for you to tell us your story.
My story, eh? Well, Liza, it started in the Isle of Wight. And what happened, when I was about 8 years of age, I was bored with the holidays at school. So the milkman came round one day and I said, can I have a ride in your van? And he said, oh, lovely. So I went out in the van with him. And of course, any long drive we had to take milk up to, he said, go on, son. So we did that. And then I started working on the farm as well. And then one day I got home and there was a letter for me. First letter I'd ever received in my life. And I said to my mother, what's this? She said, well, I don't know, love. And there was a postcard in there saying, could you please come down to the cinema and tell us what song you're singing in the talent competition on Sunday? I said to my mother, what's all this about? Well, she said, look, love, you know, I just stuck your name in, you know, and so forth. So I thought, well, in for a penny, in for a pound. I went down there and saw him and went on Sunday to do the competition. And there was, you know, sort of rock and rollers there, you know, and the odd comedian and so forth. And I did a song called Love Letters in the Sand, which is a Pat Boone song.
I remember
on a day like today, we pass the time away. And I won that heat. And then I went into the final. And in the final, as I say, I had all Tom, Dick and Harry in there and things. And this was just before Christmas. So I sang Mary's Boy Child. And it was so different to everybody else on the show that I won it. And I won a fiver. And the guy who owned the cinema was a guy called Colonel Britton in the Isle of Wight. And he had two cinemas. And his son said to me, I'm going to put another show on in the other cinema in a few months' time, and I'd like you to come on and do a few songs. So he looked into the hit parade to find out who's going to put on the show, and there were the Mudlarks there. Mm-hmm. And he said, oh, they're good, they are, you know. And so anyway, he had to find out whose agent, who's the agent was, which was Buddy Lewis. And he called him, and we fixed the Mudlarks. And so he invited, this guy called Robin Britton, he invited Bunny and Janique to the Isle of Wight. They had a beautiful house in Bedbridge, and to come and see the show. So they came to see the show, and I went on, and I can't remember what I sang now even then. It was so nerve-wracking. And Janique and Bunny sort of looked at one another, and I think Janique said something like, I think we got another Perry Como here, you know. And that's how it all really sort of started. So then I came to London to have singing lessons and elocution lessons as well. Because I used to go home, you know, my mother used to say, I said,
We studied with the same teacher, Professor Cunelli. Wasn't he marvellous?
That's right, Professor Cunelli, yeah. And before that, I went to Mabel Corran, 543 Finchley Road. I always remember it because I always thought of her when I was driving up to go to the M1. Yes. And and I had elocution lessons as well.
Who did you study elocution with? Was it Flossie Friedman?
No, it was a lady called Ruth Lodge, mm-hmm. who lived down in Chelsea. Mm-hmm. Lovely, lovely lady. But when I used to go home, occasionally my mother wouldn't speak to me, and I said, what's the problem? Well, I don't know, she said. You comes home here, talking posh and things. I said, well, no, look, you see, if I do a film or something, people won't understand what I'm talking about. Oh, blimey, she said, I never realised that, you know, and we got a lucky house on fire after that. But as you say, after the singing teacher...
Cunelli.
Yeah, I went to him after Mabel Corran, mm-hmm. that's right. And he was wonderful.
Oh, he was the master,
yeah,
wasn't he?
Yeah, wonderful guy.
When you're taught by him, you stay taught.
Oh yeah, without a doubt.
Yes.
I had a lovely lady called Nichols, She's in Coronation Street. And she had a flat just down the road from him. Well, we were sort of going out at the time. And I thought, well, that's marvellous, you know, because if I'm staying, you know, with her, then I could pop in and have my lesson in the morning, you know. Which I did. And I started the lesson. He said, oh, la, 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 la. He said, oh, c'est terrible. I said, what's the matter? He said, you naughty boy last night, huh?
Oh, yes,
I'm very tired. You're very tired. You come back tomorrow.
Yeah, well, yes, that was
lovely,
Professor
lovely
Kinelli.
Sense of humour, yeah, yeah. Yes. And then literally...
You could never fool him.
No, no, never. And eventually, probably another 2 or 3 months went by or something, and Bunny phoned up and said that I've got a television show for you, which was 6-5 Special. Mm-hmm. Which is an amazing show when you think about it, because it was live at 6:05 on a Saturday. And the trouble is, you know, I remember Pete Murray introducing me, and I'm standing there like this, and I'm thinking, what's that third line in the song, you know? And all of a sudden, the light went on, and that's it. You had to do it. Mm-hmm. And it's very frightening, because I was just, well, coming up at 16 years of age then. So. And then that sort of got it going, really. Of course, then we had, you know, your Cliffs and all that around and so forth. And it just sort of took off. And then it was like another television show. Well, we've got to get a record out now. Mm-hmm. So I did a song called Come Softly to Me, which was recorded by Frankie Vaughan, mm-hmm. the Case Sisters. And it used to go, what is it? In doobie doo dum dum, dummy doo dum, in doobie doo dum dum. Yeah. And so that got my name over. And then I did Teenager in Love, of course. Which
was the very big hit for you, wasn't it?
Well, it was
you
the second.
You sold more than Sam Cooke.
Yeah. And Marty did as well, Marty mm-hmm. Well. And of course, the one after that was Only 16, yes. Which was number one for about 6-7 weeks. And the extraordinary thing is about that, we used to find out, or Bunny and Janine used to find out, what the hit parade was like on a Tuesday. And it used to be released on a Thursday. And I used to phone in and say, what's happened this week? Cliff is still at number one with Livin' Doll. Oh dear, oh dear. And after a few weeks, I phoned up. I said, what's happened now? They said, Cliff is off the number one spot. I said, what about me? He said, you're at number one now. And it was marvellous.
Oh, such a lovely feeling.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
And I had a nice photograph from Cliff saying, I'm glad it was you that I gave the number one spot to.
He's quite a gentleman, isn't he?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm. And so that's, you know, having a number one, for instance. And then I was very lucky, actually, got to have another 5 or 6 after that. And then that was 1959. Mm-hmm. And then I started recording, you know, fairly regularly actually, and then going out on tour and things in the theatres, which was lovely, because you used to do twice a night, 6:15 mm-hmm. and 8:30, these lovely theatres. But although I was like 16 at the time, it was marvellous. Wonderful working with people like Tommy Trinder and things, and standing on the side of the stage and just watching it, and the timing was absolutely magic. And so I worked with a lot of comics, and you had to, in those days you had wonderful sort of puppet shows and what I would call variety,
mm-hmm, yes.
You know, which you don't get anymore.
No.
Everybody else was a totally different act on the bill. Uh-huh. And they were great days.
It was the Moss Empire.
The Moss Empires, yeah. Yeah. Sort of all the Manchesters and Liverpools and so forth. And that's all right, it's only the mail. And, they were good days. And I met a lot of artists in those days, who in that case had been in the business for maybe 25-30 years.
Yes.
And they'd done everything. And you learned a hell of a lot from them. You really did. Yes, how to make up and things like that, you know.
Yes.
And then we shared a lot of digs together, which was good, because all the stories started coming out then.
Those dig stories, they're insurpassable, aren't they?
I remember I used to stay at Mrs. Mackay's in Manchester, and she had two houses there. One house for the actors and actresses, and the other one for the variety artists like myself. Because we used to get in at 1-2 o'clock in the morning or something, and the others were up in bed at 10 o'clock because they got to get up in the morning, you know, to go to work. And the very first time I was up there, I'd arranged with Fred Mudd, the Mudlarks, to go and have a game of golf with them. So I was up so early, and he was up so early, that we went in and sat down where all the actors and actresses were. And there were Ken Roach and all that from Carnation Street. And I said, you know, what are you doing up? Oh, we're just doing a little series thing here called Carnation Street. You know, we'll probably be here for about 6 months or something like that. And
Made careers out of that one soap opera.
And so even then, you see, you met people. I've, you know, people like your Liz Dawn and things. In fact, I did her 60th birthday. Apparently she was a fan of mine about 4 years ago, 4 or 5 years ago. And they phoned me and said, oh, she's a big fan of yours, you know. Would you come up and do a couple of songs for her? Which I did. And then I phoned them and I said, does she have a favourite song? And, oh yeah. And whatever it was, I learnt it. And when I got out there, I called her up on stage and I said, what's your favourite song? She said, so-and-so. I said, it's not, is it? Come on, let's do it together. She said, you know, it was quite an old song. I said, yeah, so we did it together. And it was terrific. It really was.
Incredible memories there.
And then when, then the Beatles came along, of course.
And the business changed vastly, didn't
it? Without a doubt. Without a doubt, yeah. I was asked to go up to Liverpool. I think it was somebody who couldn't do the show. Asked me to go up there to do a show. I said, fine, lovely. And so I got up there and I took my keyboard player with me. I knock on the dressing room door, come in. And, oh, my name's Brian Epstein. Chat, chat, chat. I said, are the boys ready for rehearsal? He said, yeah, sure. And my keyboard player said, do they read music? He said, not really, you know. And he said, oh, here we go, Craig, you know, we'll do the act all in the same key, you know. Anyway, we go down there, and there was John, Paul, George, and Ringo. So we did the, it was on the Little Richard show. Little Richard was topping the bill. And so we did the rehearsal, and it was fine, actually. And I heard them, actually, after the rehearsal in their dressing room, and Paul saying, now it's in E-flat, like, you know. You go from the E-flat down to D, and they were rehearsing the songs again, which I thought it was really marvellous of them.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah, it was terrific. And
a bit nerve-wracking, though, from your point of view.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. But I had my keyboard player with me, so that was good. And on the second day, which we only did 2 days there, I was staying in Chester. And after the show, I said goodbye to everybody and went down to the tunnel. I had to go through the tunnel with the car to go to Chester. And the guide only used to come on duty. And so I gave him a £20 note, I think it was, and he said, oh, can't change that, son, you know. I've only just come on duty. I thought, oh, dear. So I backed the car back, went into the theatre, and bumped into John Lennon. And I said, excuse John, I said, can you change a £20 note? She said, change one? I've never seen one. You know? And he lent me a fiver.
Oh, bless him.
To go through the tunnel. Oh. And it was terrific.
Kind, lovely.
And of course, the thing is, as only everybody, all they wanted to know about then was groups, you know. So Bunny and Janine and I sat down and said, what are we going to do? You know, they don't want to know about groups. And so Bunny said, well, look, you've had 2 or 3 hit records in Australia. They've asked you to go there 2 or 3 occasions. You couldn't do it because of the work you were doing in England. Go and see the world. So I went out to Australia And strange enough, the agent phoned up, and I took out, you'd know this, the microphone, you know, they've got a lead, the radio microphone, yeah. Because they said, could you bring a couple? I said, yeah, sure. And because they'd never used them. So I went out there, I did the first show, and halfway through the show, I was walking into the audience, hello, love, all right, you know, and this, that, and the other. We got all these complaints yesterday to say that I was miming my songs because they said we didn't see the lead on the radio mic, and so we had to switch over. But it was good fun, you see, going to somewhere like Australia.
Yes. And,
well,
see, how long were you down there for?
Well, I went for 3 months initially, and then I went on 2 or 3 occasions because of the, you know, the hit records and so forth. And then I started. That's when I started virtually sort of travelling the world, which was wonderful. It really was. And I used to meet even friends like myself, like Matt Monroe and things. Mm-hmm. He'd just been finishing a hotel somewhere, and I was taking over from him. So, so I went to Australia, and then I went to Kenya, East Africa and South Africa. And there, in South Africa, where I used to do 3 months there, no, 4 months, because we used to do Johannesburg for a month, and then go to Cape Town, Durban, and Port Elizabeth.
Yes.
And it was terrific because we used to do like 3.5 weeks in one place, then fly to the other place, and we'd have 3 or 4 days to take it easy and see the place. And it was a good
yes, they
good
were
talk.
Lovely trips.
Oh, yeah, smashing, yeah.
Yes, I followed you into a gig in Kuala Lumpur.
Oh, KL, yeah.
Yes, yes.
I'm just trying, yeah, because the guy...
I've forgotten the name of the place there.
Yeah, well, the guy that ran it, he was Irish.
That's it, yes.
Because he used to run a hotel in Cheltenham.
Uh-huh.
And I worked that 3 or 4 times.
Yes.
And lost sight of him, didn't hear from him, got a note from him, from KL, and saying, listen, Craig, you've got to come out, you know, and this, that, and the other. So I went out there, and funnily enough, I was thinking about him a couple of days ago. And I'll think of his name in a minute, but, you know, names now are getting a bit dodgy.
With all of us, the computer gets overloaded,
yeah, right.
Craig.
Yeah, yeah. And then when I went to... where else did I? Well, I went to Hong Kong. I did the Mandarin in Hong Kong, and I used to do it twice a year.
Yes.
Which is wonderful.
That was a lovely gig.
Oh, it
was
smashing. And the lovely thing about it, when I lived in Knightsbridge, there was a lovely couple lived in the flat 2 floors below me, and got on very well with them. One day, I came out of the flat, and I saw the removal van there. I thought, what's going on there? And I spoke to her, and she said, oh, we're going to Hong Kong. Her husband had been transferred in his job to Hong Kong. So, and I got a card from them occasionally, and it was about 3 years later when I went to the Mandarin. And I'd forgotten that they lived in Hong Kong. And I went on first night, and they were sat in the front row.
Small world, isn't it?
It's a very, very small world, yeah. And you meet people that you thought, well, I'd never see again. You know? And then from Hong Kong, I remember Bunny calling me saying, before you come back to London, we want you to go to the Philippines to entertain the American troops. They were in Alangapo City, where the naval base was. And so I went to Manila with my keyboard player, and we stayed in Manila for 3 days. We couldn't go out at night because there was a curfew on.
Yes.
But the agent said, oh, don't worry about that because we fix things up for you. You know, I said, oh, thanks for that. You know. Then they flew us by helicopter down to Alangapo City, and they had we entertained the American troops for about 6 days, and it was lovely actually because all the at night they'd get about 100 girls, and they'd all sign in and things, and it was all properly done to go in and say hello and chat to the boys, and they'd buy them drinks and things. And at 11 o'clock, that's it. Come on, girls. And it was all above board, and I thought it was really wonderful. And of course, that's when I first stuck a Beatles medley in the act, of course, tore the place apart.
Yes,
you know.
Would do. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's wonderful. And then I went up to the air base as well by helicopter. They flew me up there, Clarkson Air Base. And I did about 5 days up there or something. Mm-hmm. And all those, you know, places that, you know, you've heard about but never seen.
Yes, it was a whole new form of show business in the Far East, wasn't it?
Oh, yes.
In those days.
Yeah, yeah.
That people who were on the crest of the wave here didn't know about at all.
They no, no.
Didn't
no.
need those countries.
No. And also in a lot of those countries, you see, you still got a lot of English people there.
Yes.
So yeah. I had to go on and sing the hits, for instance. Mm-hmm. It was good.
Yes.
And then I went to... then I started, for instance, although a lot of clubs had closed here and things, and as you know, because you've done it as well, I used to do Quaglino's
yes.
quite a lot.
That was a lovely day. That was beautiful.
Oh, it was smashing, yeah. Not too large. And
and the society was nice. That
I know.
That tramp, didn't it?
That's right. I mean, one night you go in there and Princess Margaret sat there and
yes.
things. And Bunny used to, I used to do some special material.
Mm-hmm.
And Buddy used to write things for me, and we used to mention names in the song.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd look at the newspapers in the morning, check who was good in the newspapers, and incorporate them in the songs, which got a lot of laughs.
I'm sure.
Yeah. And I used to do another song, and I used to say, I can almost read your minds. And... And I used to say, if I could read your minds, I think I'd kind of see a lot of little questions there concerning me. For instance, where's he been? When was his last hit? You think it's 72, but you'd have decided to quit. He hasn't got long hair. He even looks quite clean. In fact, he's so damn square, he has to be and has been. Thank God the lighting here is quite kind. I can almost read your minds. To think not long ago, he was a teenage rave, and now the only place he'll get laid is in the grave. You wonder what's beneath that nightclub tan. Deep down inside, is he a dirty old man? I bet he's deep in debt. I'm sure he's hired his clothes. As he's not married yet, could he be one of those? I bet he pinched his girls behind. I can always read your minds. And the extraordinary thing is, most of those lines I've actually heard.
Yes.
When I've been in a restaurant and people have recognised me, so people say, "Do you think he's one of those?" Or something, you know. I bet he pinched his girls behind. You know. And a lot of those lines actually came from. The public.
Just listening to people.
Oh, yeah. And also, when you see television today, you see singers going on in jeans and this and that. In those days, you know, it cost me £600 for a suit.
Oh, yes.
You
yes.
know, made in Savile Row or something.
And it was always a dress suit.
Oh, yeah.
Bow tie. I mean,
and that was lovely in Hong Kong because I met a guy there called Danny. Lovely guy. Now, he said, I want to make you some shirts. I said, well, all right, you know, sort of thing. So I gave him one of my shirts that I had made here. And he said, "Be ready tomorrow." I said, no, don't be ready tomorrow. I said, "You just take your time." And which he did. It cost me a tenner. Had monogram on there and everything. And he said to me, "Now, what about trousers?" Now, in my stage shoot, I always had two pairs of trousers. One had pockets and the other didn't. So I said, "Look, copy these." So I gave him a pair of trousers. And he made me 4 or 5, and I thought, well, I had a white pair and so forth. I thought, I'd play golf with those. And when I got back, I took him to play golf, you know, and I got on the first tee, and I went to put some tees, you know, ball tees in my pocket, and I thought, where's the pocket? I'd given him the wrong pair of trousers, the ones without the pockets, so, it was crazy, but it was absolutely, it's lovely out there.
Oh, but Hong Kong was the place to come back with loads of clothes.
Oh, God, yeah. Yeah, it was marvellous.
24 hours, you know.
Yeah, and funny enough, actually, after a while, a couple of the shirts started going a bit here. So when I went back the following year, I got hold of Danny. He said, "Ah, you wanted some shirts?" I said, "Yeah." I'd have some more shirts, but I said, I want you to use this cotton, because it was much thicker, it was English cotton, much thicker. And he said, why is that? I said, well, because the other one, the shirt was coming out here. He said, okay. Of course, they were marvellous then, you see.
Yes.
So he used the cotton.
Now, when you came back from touring the world, what did you do then? Because you formed niches for yourself to survive in the business today. And well, it's very interesting how you've done this.
Well, cruising came aboard then.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to do the old Canberra and the old Oriana and things. And in those days, of course, they have first and second class.
Yes.
So you'd do your early show for the second class passengers and the other show for the first class. So you change the act a little bit as well, you know. Although sometimes it didn't work because a lot of the first class passengers didn't have a lot of rapier, but they had money, you know, so they didn't get the gags and things. But I only ever did two at a time because I had colleagues of mine who went cruising and started having a drink down in the ordinary bar. And this is marvellous, you know, and all. Stay on for ages and ages and become alcoholics.
Very easily done.
Oh, very easily done.
There's not a lot else to do on those.
No, there isn't. And also, you see, going to certain places, you get in at 7 o'clock in the morning, leave at 7 o'clock at night. So you didn't have a great deal of time. I had some good times on the QE2 when I used to go. I did the run from Southampton to New York for a month. And that was just 6 days. Now I think it's 5 or something. And that was good fun because you had Americans and all sorts of people on board. But as I say, I never did more than two at a time, you know, because as I say, you can get stuck in a rut.
Very much so.
Oh yeah.
And you have a captive audience, you don't stretch your craft either.
No,
much
that's
as
right.
You do never. When you're on land.
Yeah.
How and now, of pantomime, course. Pantomime, did you enjoy that?
Oh God, I loved it. I did, I must have done probably 20 odd or something. And the nice thing about that was actually working with a load of people.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you're working on your own, you're on your own and things.
Can be very lonely.
Yeah. Driving and so forth. And so I used to go to the rehearsals and things. And two or three people obviously knew because they were topping the bill as well as me and so forth. And all the dancers and things. And in those days, of course, we'd start Boxing Day and finish about 1st of March. Long time. Now they're about 4 or 5 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
I remember going with Cam and the Ball to the Alhambra in Bradford,
mm-hmm.
and that finished 1st of March, and it was packed every night. And the strange thing is, they hadn't been in the business very long, Canada Moore, and I rented a house in Haworth.
Yes.
And one day, I woke up early in the morning, and it was snowing like mad. I thought, I better leave early, get to the theatre, which I did. The only two people who didn't get to the theatre was Canada Bull.
Mm-hmm.
They said, oh, I'm not going to theatre tonight, not with snow out like that, you know,
yeah.
and so forth. But they were actually living in Leeds, I think, at the time, so it was a bit of a way.
Right.
And so we had to cancel the show. But I loved every minute of pantomime. I really did. And you had good songs in there, you had a good band in the pit.
And there's nothing like those kids screaming at you. Oh,
I know,
fantastic
yeah.
Fantastic feeling.
Oh, those little kids, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So, and also the lovely things that can happen there, you know, you can forget your lines and you know, if you've got a comic with you or something, you forget the lines and he says, another comic would cover it up. But this one, I say, come on, what are you going to say? You've forgotten your lines, haven't you? And I said, yeah, you know, and so forth. And it's good fun for kids, isn't it, really?
Absolutely.
As far as children.
You made a film once, didn't you?
Yeah, I did a film called It's Trad Dad.
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, I did. One reason I enjoyed it was Dick Lester directed it. Wonderful, wonderful sense of humour. I remember him saying to me, right, Craig, you've got to walk down this passageway, right? Now, when you walk down here, you'll see on your right-hand side a door. Now, before you get there, just and I walk round it. I said, oh, yeah. Oh, all right then, you know. I said, well, what's happening then? He said, well, there's an elephant coming out the door, you know. Wonderful sense, and that's what, you know, happened in there. Oh, it's a wonderful, terrific sense of humour. And of course, it was the first one I'd done, so I was a bit wary of everything. And Helen was in it, Helen Shapiro.
She's a friend of yours, isn't
she? Oh, yeah,
she?
Good friend, yes. Yeah. And what they did, all the acts, they did the American acts in America, the English acts here, and then put them all together. And it was a good old rave up, really. And Helen and I had this sort of love affair, love friendship and things. Mm-hmm. That's when I really first got to meet her. And then I did a musical called No No Nanette.
Yes.
Which I did on tour for about 8 or 9 months. Mm-hmm. And that was a good experience because I was working with actors and actresses, you know, and there's me, a singer. But I did have acting lessons as well before I did them with a guy called Clifford Turner, mm-hmm. who was at RADA and sort of privately and things. And it was a very, very good experience, good songs as well. And one of the girls in the show, in fact, I spoke to her about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I'd spoken to her for years. She said to me, listen, I've got to tell you, she said, Nanette is upstaging you. Mm-hmm. I said, upstaging me? What do you mean? Well, when you go on stage, you see, and she shouts out, Tom, you look upstage there and say, what do you want, Nanette? And if you look upstage, they can't see your face. I said, God, I didn't realise. Oh, yeah. She said,
very naughty.
Yeah, very naughty. So the following night, I went on, walked straight on stage. I said, Nanette! I didn't look round. She said, yes, Tom. I said, come here. She came there, and she said, and then we carried on with the conversation. And when we came on stage, she said to me, don't you ever do that to me again. I said, listen, love, you know. You've been doing this for the last 2 or 3 weeks. I thought, I'll let you get away with it for a while, but not, you know, as if I knew. You know, but you never did it after that. All those silly little things you learn.
And it takes such a long time to learn.
It does, actually, yeah.
Doesn't it?
Yeah. And then I did, this is a lovely story, I did a musical at the Old Mill at Sonny, which is a lovely old place, right on the Thames. And it's so lovely to go there for rehearsals in the morning. And see the Thames there, and we used to have lunch on the lawn and this and the other. And there was a lovely guy called John Judd, who was in the show. And the show was written by the guy that wrote the Tom Jones songs, Les Reed. Mm-hmm. And anyway, we had some lovely songs. Les was in it as well, playing piano. And on the first night, we finished the show. And I was sharing a dressing room with John Judd, his name is John Williams. And anyway, Helen walked in the dressing room. I said, Helen, how lovely to see you. It's terrific for you to come down and see me on my first night. She said, I didn't come to see you, I came to see him. I said, what do you mean? And John looked round and said, oh, we're married. Oh. I didn't realise they were husband and wife.
Uh-huh.
And he'd never told me during rehearsals and things.
Really?
It was a musical called And Then I Wrote. Uh-huh. And we did it for about a month or 6 weeks. So that was another good experience.
Did you ever consider shooting for a soap opera? Like going into Coronation Street
Not
or
really,
EastEnders or
no,
any
no.
of those?
I don't watch them. I don't know why. You see, I mean, television in these days, if you look at, like, tonight's television, for instance, you've got about 5 soaps on, you know. So I go and watch things like Country Life, mm-hmm. I watch University Challenge, Mastermind, mm-hmm. and things like that. Because if you miss 5 or 6 episodes, probably, of Coronation Street or something, you know, unless you tape it, then what's the point of watching it again anyway, you know.
Also, not too much happens, you can pick it up later.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. So I've never really been interested in that.
Because Barbara Windsor went into soap, Stennett, and
it's amazing.
A variety of people had a crack at it.
Yeah.
And seemed to get a couple of years' work out of it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And longer.
Well, you think some of them have been there, you know, like Roach has been in there for 50 years or something.
Yes.
You know.
They build their entire careers around them. It's very fortunate if they're able to do that, I suppose.
And also, it's a hallway, isn't it, really? That's all.
Yes.
In our case, we go here, we go there, do this, that, that. But to go to the studios every day, it's...
You're not kept on your toes, so
you're not kept... No. And you're earning money. That's the main thing about it.
Yes.
You're earning money. So, you know, I've never really got into that.
Do you come from a large family, Craig?
Yes, I've got a photograph back there of my mother and the family. My mother had three sets of twins, had nine of us.
Wow.
So she had a set of boys. I always have to think about this. Set of boys, a girl, twin boys, my brother and I, then a boy, boy and girl twins, and a girl.
Wow.
So she had one twins and a single one.
Now then, in between. Do they live on the Isle of Wight?
They all live on... Well, I've lost three of them. I've just got two brothers and two sisters left now.
Uh-huh. Is your twin...
No, my twin's gone.
I see.
And one of the other twins, my sister, is gone as well. She wasn't very well. I took her on a cruise, actually, and so forth, before she went. And she was lovely, you know.
Well, you've still 50s. Got quite a lot,
though. Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, I see them all when I go down, when I go home.
Ah, that must have.
Got,
they're so pleased to see you. They
yeah.
must be so proud of you.
Oh, yes, it's lovely, yeah.
Yes.
And I see their nephews and nieces and things, and it's amazing. If you go down every 2 years or something, you see a little nephew or niece like that, and then they're up here.
Yes.
It's incredible. Billy Eckstein and I followed in the Mandarin once.
Yes.
And a lovely man, and I had 2 or 3 days there before I started, so I got to know him sort of quite well.
Nice singer.
He said to me, "Do you ever sit down in your suit before you go on stage?" I said, "Well, no, not unless it's a bit late or something." And they said, "Well, we'll give you another 5 minutes, you know, and you sit down." He said, "He said I once went on stage in America, and I'd done the same thing. And this guy came round to me and he said, 'Listen, don't you ever sit in your suit, because your suit looked awful.'"
Yes.
And that was Frank Sinatra.
Yes.
And apparently, before he went on stage, he had his suits hung up on the side of the stage.
Mm-hmm.
And just before they announced him, he put it on and walked on stage.
Professional.
It's lovely, isn't
totally
it?
Totally a professional.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. It's lovely.
Now, then, you've been working for in the business for 53 years now.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a pretty good record.
It's not bad. It's just, yeah, it's not bad. Yeah.
Oh, what a survivalist you must be.
Yeah, we've had our ups and downs, obviously.
But
know.
Any career does.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, now, you see, a lot of the work now is sort of weekends, Saturday and Sunday.
Yes. Are you at the stage now, Craig, where that suits you?
Yes, it is, actually, in a way, yeah, yeah. Because I like to do my bits of charity work as well.
Yes. What charity are you into?
Well, I've got a couple of hospices that I sort of, you know, and I do shows for them and things mm-hmm. like that. And
Marvelous.
A few years ago I had a place in the Isle of Wight, which I used to sponsor and do shows, and I used to do shows. The money I made, I used to put up, it was for handicapped children.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just near a farm. And I used to put up some greenhouses for them and used to go and see the kids, you know. Of course, a lot of them came from London and things. They'd never seen a greenhouse as a farm, pigs or anything.
And, it's hard to believe, isn't it?
Yeah. And when you think they put a just a little seed in a pot plant and then see it grow, you know, and see their faces. It was absolutely lovely.
Makes you realise how lucky you and I were.
Yeah, yeah. And also I do the odd show for with the water rats as well,
uh-huh.
and which is good fun. I haven't done so much lately because I've got to find somebody to have a driver, you know, and then I've got my
tell
wheelchair.
Us, will you tell us about...
I've got a...
Call it your accident, because I'm sure you're going to recover from it.
Well, I hope so, yeah, yeah. It's called vasculitis, and what happened, my immune system was so low that I caught an infection in my leg, and the immune system didn't sort it out, and the neurologist, Professor Riley, just took a nerve out of my ankle and found it was inflamed. And so that all my nerve ends are all inflamed, and there's very little they can do about them. And also you can get them, apparently, well, when I was in hospital, there was a guy there, you can get it in your hands, in your arms as well.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, because this guy was being fed by the mouth of things. So, so it was a bit of drag, because I can't play my golf anymore, can't drive, and I can't run after women, because I can't run.
Oh, no, that is tragic. I mean, that's dreadful.
That's the worst thing about it all, yeah.
Well, you're just going to have to get an electronic wheelchair.
Yeah.
One that goes a bit faster than the others.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Now, so, you work out at the gymnasium here, and you swim, and you stay on top of it.
I try to. It's very difficult to get up in the morning and think, oh, I go through this again. Of course, taking your pills, your insulin, you know, and all this, that, the other, so... Here we go again, you know, and so forth.
But you're a toughie.
Well,
you're going to be just fine. You really are.
Well, I hope so, yeah.
I promise you.
Yeah.
This you're going to put behind you, and as I said before we did the show, we're both born under the sign of Leo. This is a very good year for Leo's.
Well, I hope so, yeah.
I think something really great career-wise and health-wise is going to happen for you this year.
Well, we'll keep in touch and
we'll find
out.
You well deserve it. In my book, you're a real classy gent. And
thank you.
It's been a privilege talking to you.
And you too, and thanks for inviting me.
Thank
you. Next time I'm down your
in.
Way, if I am, I'll call you and pop in and
I wish you would. That would be lovely. That would be really fantastic.
I got a friend down there, the Laughing Onion restaurant.
Yes. Where?
In Brighton.
In Brighton.
Yeah. Good friend of mine, actually. He's French. And I got him into the restaurant, really. Because he had I used to go and have the odd meal with him when I lived in Knightsbridge in his flat. Uh-huh. I used to cook these marvellous meals.
Really?
I said, you ought to do something about this, you know. And there was a little bistro around the corner, and I told them about it. And he used to take stuff round for them and things. And that's how it all started. And, of course, he's getting on a bit now, so he's retired.
Yes.
But I used to go down and have a meal down at the Laughing Onion in Brighton.
Before we wrap this up, Craig, you've travelled, you've met loads and loads of terrific people. Who comes to mind and stands out more than anybody else in your life?
Oh, it's a tough question, that. It really is. I mean, there's so many in a sense, you know.
Name a few.
Well, as I say, you know, people, you know, like Billy Eckstein and things.
Yes.
And and there was another guy I met when I was in Nairobi working, a guy called John Tate, mm-hmm. who was a heavyweight boxer. Lovely, lovely man. And I used to chat to him, you know, in the lounge. And he came in one day after training in the park. Hi, Craig. I said, hi, John, you know. And he went up to the reception. He said, can you call the police and tell them there's two or three guys on the ground in the park? What had happened? They didn't know who he was. He was jogging and things like this, and they attacked him.
Oh.
So he just turned around and wallop, 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 and they were on the ground. And he phoned the police.
On the wrong person.
Yeah, picked up on the wrong person and things, yeah. No, there's loads of people actually, really. Liza, I don't know.
Who influenced you most?
Well, I think Bunny and Janique, really, actually. Because they were like a mother and father to me, you know.
Yeah.
And people I loved Nat King Cole, for instance, as well. Mm-hmm. I met him once. And another guy I met was Buzz Aldrin. Mm-hmm. When I was in Nairobi, I went to Mount Kenya Safari Club. Uh-huh. And I saw they were having a meeting there. And Michael Wilding, is it Michael Wilding, the American actor?
British actor. Michael Wilding was British, wasn't he?
I'm trying to think of the American
one. Married Elizabeth Taylor.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think of the American one. Anyway, he was there with Bing Crosby who I met when we were doing his Trandad. He used to out in the film studios, and he was putting on the lawn and things, and I got to know. And there was him and a guy called Joe Block, who owned a few hotels in Nairobi, and Buzz Aldrin was there, and they all had money in Mount Kenya Safari Club. And I got Buzz Aldrin's autograph. I still can't find it today, but when I move from here, I'm sure I'll find it tucked away.
Cosmic ordering, you'll find it. Okay, thank you very much indeed again, Craig, and
Liza,
to be continued.
Lovely to see you. Thank you very much indeed. Bye-bye.